Hi friends, thank you very much for being here today. We are very excited to welcome Dr. Hi. We are very excited to welcome Dr. Ben Orlov to our colloquium. Dr. Orlov received his PhD in anthropology from UC Berkeley in 1975. He has taught at UC Davis in the Department of Environmental Sciences and Policy. And since 2010, he has been teaching and doing research at Columbia University, where he is one of the directors of the Center for Research on Environmental Decisions. He's also a senior research scientist at the International Research Institute for Climate and Society. Dr. Orlov is also a former editor-in-chief for Current Anthropology, now editor of the website Glacier Hub, a scientific outreach initiative providing information about current research on glacier retreats, telling stories of people who live near glaciers or visit them, and documenting the efforts of communities and organizations to address the challenges brought by glacier retreats. Glacier Hub is conceived as a nexus to link people who are concerned about glaciers so that they can develop responses to climate change. This reflects Dr. Orlov's more recent research orientation towards climate change and glacier retreat, looking at the natural hazards they cause and the loss of iconic landscapes. He expanded from his original fieldwork in the Caribbean Andes, where he did research on economic processes and pastoralism, to new field sites in Uganda, Australia, and Italy. Dr. Orlov has been publishing about climate change in a global perspective with an ethnographic attention to local case studies. And today, he will present sections of his upcoming book on glaciers. So please welcome Dr. Ben Orlov.
Well, thank you very much for that kind introduction. Wonderful to be here, honored by this invitation, very glad to see some old friends and colleagues and some new faces. And as you'll see, it's also particularly, it's very nice to be giving a talk about this book in a museum, because it turns out I'm actually writing in a museum. I'm on sabbatical this year in New York, and so I found a desk at the American Museum of Natural History, and it's been a chance to reflect quite a bit on museums and museums and spaces and things that people do. And I was thinking that I wanted to, how is I going to link my talk to the title of the series, which is called Natures, and that came up with the introduction in my biography. There was the question of my a department that I taught in Davis, the Department of Environmental Science and Policy, which had started off as a Division of Environmental Studies, and then there was some people felt that sciences were better than studies. I think you can imagine who those people were. But there were many, many meanings about whether here we have the word natures, but it was reminding me that we had long debates about whether we'd be environmental science or environmental sciences, which turned out to be a question partly about physical scientists and biologists being separate or together, but also whether science was to be understood in its unity or its diversity, which of course end up being the same thing. But I realized that I put in, thought the train would be a chance to catch up on my journal reading, and so I discovered that I had in my bag, did not plan, these are, here's science and here's nature. They are both single. It's interesting in a way to think that these prominent, that they're not called, certainly not called sciences, and absolutely not called natures. So here are really the two most prominent journals from the two sides of the Atlantic that have converged in their size, in their typefaces, and in their coextensiveness, because anything that can belong to science can belong to nature, and vice versa. And where are we as anthropologists? But there certainly are many ways of thinking, many ways of engaging with nature, and this is very glad to be part of the series. What I thought I would do would, or what in fact I intend to do and will do, is to read a section of the book. It'll start with a bit that I think will remain as in the first chapter, and then it kind of morphs into some material that's actually taken from kind of a book description or a prospectus that I think may also find its way into the into the introduction. So that's going to give you a sense of that, and then I think I'll just be talking about the book. The book is about glaciers. I was thinking I'd read the talk and I wouldn't have any pictures, but there's one on the back wall, and it's a lovely picture. It's huge, and I didn't sneak in this morning to put it up. And it's also the things I could say that I'm pretty sure that those are glaciers, although those could just be late spring snowfields. But it does look like some of those are going to remain. And there is something about high mountain landscapes that there's a certain convergence around the world. So it wasn't till I saw that those creatures, I'm fairly sure, are yaks, that we'd put this somewhere in Asia. Somewhere probably on the north side of the Himalayas, because of the sort of large flat lake. You wouldn't have those on the south side. But it's anyway, they're lovely landscapes. So here's some sections, and then maybe I might ask for some questions then, and then continue talking. To the people who drive north from Seattle on I-5, the freeway that hugs Puget Sound in Washington State, Mount Baker is first visible as a small triangle on the horizon. It grows larger to those who turn east onto the two-lane roads that head inland towards the Cascade Range. They soon see more details, the lower slopes covered densely with fir, hemlock, and cedar, and the broad expanses of snow and ice higher up. As they continue closer to the mountain summit, the roads wind through narrow canyons with tall trees on either side. The Baker vanishes from sight for long stretches, only to appear at a bend or a rise, looming immense and white against the sky. Travelers in northern Italy can take a similar trip, following the Adige River from its mouth in the Adriatic Sea, up across a broad coastal plain, and through a valley that grows narrower as it ascends in elevation. The mountains here are the Alps, not the Cascades, as in Washington. The forests are composed of different species, spruce and larch and pine, and they do not reach quite as close to the snow and ice, leaving a prominent band of rock and scree between the two. But here, too, a mountain comes into view, Ortler, standing well above the other peaks that are arrayed on both sides of it. Taken together, they form the largest ridge in the South Tyrol, this section of the Alps. And here, too, approaching the mountain makes it seem to grow larger, a gleaming mass broad in its base with a single sharp point at its summit. The analogous trip in Peru is almost always taken in reverse from above, entering the river, the valley of the Santa River, not at its mouth on the Atlantic, on the Pacific Ocean, but it's at its top at Conococha, a small reed-ringed lake set amid broad grasslands. As this valley descends from the lake, it passes between two parallel ranges, the Cordillera Negra, or Black Range, to the west, and the Cordillera Blanca, White Range, to the east, named for the snow peaks that stretch in a chain over 120 miles in length. Though far less forested than the Cascades or the Tyrolean Alps, the Cordillera Blanca contains swathes of green as well. Groves of eucalyptus make it one of the most heavily wooded sections of the high Peruvian Andes, and some relic groves of native trees as well. The drive along this section of the Santa River brings one tall peak after another into focus against the eastern horizon. Copa, higher than either Baker or Ortler, is one of the most distinctive. The traveler who comes near it can see the dark shadows in the folds of the steep cliffs near the top, a striking contrast with the long white ridge that reaches the summit and the lighter blue sky beyond. Baker, Ortler, Copa, despite differences in shape or in the forests on their lower slopes, these three mountains share a fundamental feature. They are all tall enough to reach into portions of the atmosphere where the air is much thinner and colder than at lower elevations. Temperatures remain below freezing in this high zone. Only on rare occasions do they pass a few degrees higher, and even then, any episode of warming is brief. The snow that falls does not melt, but rather accumulates, forming a cover that grows deeper every year. On all three mountains, this layer is thick enough to create pressure which alters the snowflakes, changing them first into small ice crystals, and then into the solid masses of ice that we know as glaciers. They crown the highest portions of Baker, Arbla, and Kopa, and they are all large enough to flow downslope at a pace that is literally glacial, measurable in inches per day. Even in our warming world, glacier ice is still forming in these three widely separated places. These mountains share a second feature, one that forms the central focus of this book, the small settlements with populations of 1,000 or less, located on the mountains along a stream or creek that descends directly from a glacier. Concrete and Glacier near Baker, Stilfs, Sulden, and Trafoi below Orkla, and Copa Grande close to Copa differ in many ways, as the chapters in this book reveal, but they are all shaped by their proximity to a glacier. Every child in every town grows up with an enormous mountain as a steady presence. They see it when they look out a window or the front door, or walk down a village path, or ride on a road. On some occasion, the mountain can be so familiar, barely registers in the mind. On others, looking at the sky as a storm approaches, or as an eagle or hawk or condor soars overhead, the impression is stronger. Perhaps these views accumulate as the snow does. Perhaps they also thicken and become denser, and they too transform into a new kind of material, changing into memories rather than to ice. And they may also acquire a capacity to move beyond the spot where they're formed, the memories becoming stories that travel from person to person. The ice is different now. Though it still forms on the tops of these mountains, less of it is being created each year. Like almost every spot on our planet, the mountains are warming as a consequence of the growing concentrations of greenhouse gases that trap heat in the atmosphere. The regions of sub-freezing temperatures, the areas where new glacier ice can form from snow, are contracting. Conditions are milder in the sections some distance below the mountain that were cold enough in recent decades for winter snows to survive and turn into ice, so they simply melt. Moreover, glacier ice, once formed, does not survive as long as it once did. As it travels down the mountain, it soon encounters higher temperatures and begins to melt more quickly. The glaciers lose their lowest sections, a process known by the simple evocative phrase of glacier retreat. The local residents all know that their glacier is melting, not because they've read scientific studies or heard lectures from experts, but because they've witnessed the changes with their own eyes. This direct knowledge is not restricted to the oldest people, ones who can recall earlier ages. Even adults in their 20s and 30s can point to the mountain and tell a personal story. A woman in concrete described a ridge on Baker to me. Her brother took her there on one of her first hikes. On one of her first hikes, the valley below it used to be filled with ice. Easton Glacier came lower down, and now it's just bare rock. A man in Trafoi pointed to an old stone building halfway up the Orkla. His parents used to show it to him and told him how it was built right next to the ice. They took him up there for a walk. The ice was still close when he first went there, but now it's further up the mountain. And a young woman explained to me that the meadow below a cliff, high up on Copa, used to be so close that the chunks of ice would fall right down there when she went there to herd sheep. She had to be careful. The meadow was so fresh and green, filled with wildflowers. Now it's half dried. Natural scientists have studied glaciers in detail, carefully documenting the consequences of retreat. Their work has shown that rivers below glaciers increase in volume when glaciers first melt and discharge their water that they've stored as ice, but that their flows are reduced once these supplies are depleted. They've analyzed the powerful floods that are released as lakes close to glaciers grow large enough to overtop their banks and rush down the valley. And they have demonstrated the increase in such floods in recent decades. Scientists have examined the communities of plants and animals that populate the areas which are newly exposed by the retreat. But though the consequences of changes in snow and ice are understood, the consequences of the changing views and memories of the local residents are not. What conversations do these other changes lead to, and what actions? This book offers answers to these questions. It brings forward the voices of the people who live close to the glaciers and examines their efforts to address the changes which they cannot avoid witnessing. And it confronts the near absence of the global frameworks of climate change in these places, seeking to understand why the people in general have not adopted the international vocabulary of climate change. They don't use words like adaptation and vulnerability, widely in use media policy documents. The book's divided into three sections. The first is place, which engages directly with the landscape. It examines the ways that local people inhabit and experience the places in which they live, as their forebears lived, and in which they hope to continue living. It discusses their patterns of movement through the landscape and explores their understandings of glaciers, not merely as masses of frozen water, but as entities somehow endowed with qualities associated with living beings, awareness, purposiveness, the capacity to act and to respond to the actions of others. The chapter, I'm pretty clear about the three sections. The chapters I think will evolve, but I have what are the current plans. The chapter, who knows what's going to happen? I'm curious to find out myself. The chapter, Darkness Above, describes walks in the areas newly exposed by glacier retreat. These areas, composed of rock, darker in color than the ice that formerly covered them, can be places of loss or of discovery. The ice itself discusses the physical encounters with ice, harvesting it for sale or for medicinal purposes, walking over it to travel across passes, leading and sometimes rescuing tourists on it. Streams examines the creeks and small rivers that descend directly from glaciers. They're familiar elements in the landscape, but they're ones that can change, sometimes bringing less water than expected, sometimes much more. The local people seek to manage this water so they can use it in their homes, irrigate their crops and pastures, and derive energy from hydropower facilities. And they hope as well to avoid damaging floods. But as they address their concerns about water and the streams that originate in their territories, they engage with the other groups downstream and with governments as well, who can provide financial and technical support, but who often attempt to control matters that local residents wish to keep in their own hands. The second section, called Memory, explores the ways that people recall the past. It's closely tied to the previous section, since the people all understand themselves as the successors to many others who lived in the same places, stretching back across decades and across generations to earlier historical eras in the distant past. The sense of permanence comes from many sources: old buildings and cemeteries, activities and festivals which recur each year and signal continuity, births and marriages and death, which also mark the passage of generations. But the sense of permanence is linked with particular importance to the enduring presence of the mountains which surround the communities. This bond with earlier times is a deep one, a bond which the people do not merely retain, but construct and renew in the face of pressures for change. Located far from centers of economic activity and political power, these communities may seem to outsiders to be remote and even backward. But they're not isolated and they're far from static. The same world economy that has altered glaciers by emitting greenhouse gases and emit raising temperatures has transformed their ways of life. Local people know deeply how old occupations have given way to new ones, how roads and cell phones have shortened distances, but they retain a strong sense of continuity as well. The chapter Highlanders examines conversations in which local residents express their identities as mountain peoples. This identity is common in all three areas, though it takes very different forms. In Washington State, as country people, white working Americans, dating back to the time of frontier settlement. In Italy, as inhabitants of local alpine homelands. In the Peruvian Andes, as indigenous communities, heirs to pre-European traditions. These Highlander identities mark them as distinct from others who might live in valleys or in cities and shape their engagement with the national cultures of the countries in which they live. The chapter Preserve It discusses the efforts to commemorate the former extent of ice to lower elevations than it now occurs, including festivals that evoke earlier days for locals and tourists, museums, this is a museum connection, the museums that collect and curate the objects of earlier eras recently exposed by glacier retreat, and the occasions on which local residents are called to narrate earlier times to representatives of government agencies and other organizations. The third and final section, Futures, looks at the way that people anticipate the future and undertake actions for it. It offers a counterpart to the section Memory. If the past is easily seen through the presence of mountains and other landscape features and events that other features of landscape buildings through recurring social events and events of commemoration, the future can only be made visible with some effort, tracing processes that will continue, relying on the stated intentions of others, drawing on familiar stories that offer assurances of what is to come. The mountains, again, are a key to this visualization of the future. The local people recognize that glaciers will continue to shrink, and they discuss the possibilities that they may disappear altogether. If the future of these mountains differs from the past in its visibility, it also differs in its depth. Local memories stretch far back across generations to earlier eras, encouraging people to look forward to a distant future in which their communities continue to survive, perhaps in different form. The existence of remote futures was once taken for granted, a common sense reality, even if their details were vague. But the impending loss of glaciers undermines this confidence. It can lead people to imagine a future in which their communities are not simply altered, but wholly gone. The consequences of this loss of certainty can be traced in people's conversations and at times in their actions. Unclear as the future is, the slow, inexorable, irreversible disappearance of the glaciers is a reality in the present. The section Futures explores the people's engagement with this reality and shows that their responses are connected to other forces of change in national and global economies as well. These responses are often entirely local, carried out with family and neighbors, kin and kin, you could say, but also on occasion they're developed through engagements of agencies of the state. Possible chapters include Returning, which would examine the life histories of individuals who were born and grew up in the mountains, and migrated from them to lowland cities and came back to reestablish life in their home communities, though on new terms. Meetings draws, there will be a chapter of meetings, draws on the transcripts of town meetings, village assemblies, and other gatherings to review the instances in which self-organized community groups discuss concrete projects, expanding irrigation canals, promoting tourism, that are based on local management of landscapes and that refract issues of glaciers. The chapter Buildings, I think this one will continue to, Buildings explores the physical projects in each community, system of water pipes in Peru, a hydropower station in Italy, a restored concrete plant in the US that hold the promise of prosperity in a time of change, while also providing a commentary on the changes in recent decades. A concluding chapter, Climate Change, examines the gaps between these local efforts to comprehend and respond to glacier retreat and the emerging global frameworks of climate change. It reviews the handful of points in which people in these three cases draw on this new vocabulary, such as the use of the term contamination and COPA. It explores the potential for fuller engagement between these remote mountain regions and global climate organizations and projects, and closes with reflections on broader implications of the gaps and their potentials. So that's what I've written by mid-October. I do have some additional points I can make about the book, or I could ask for questions. I don't know which.
You want to take your own question?
Sure. Yes?
So we have a question about this chapter about buildings and water infrastructure. So it strikes me that, you know, one of the things that you mentioned earlier was that water flows initially become greater during melting, but then, you know, gradually subside as the base, you know, is eroded. And so how are some of these water infrastructure projects envisioned when it's relying on a fossil resource that is only going to be continually depleted?
So, interesting question. Lots of thoughts here. One is that there is this phrase peak water, which don't ever do this at science conferences. There is a phrase peak water, which corresponds to peak oil. I've thought of the phrase peak hazards, but I think peak water is something that hydrologists can measure. But that's really something that you observe on a decade-long scale. So flow goes through an annual cycle, and there are certainly many rises and falls during the year. So I think what sometimes happens to peak water is gradual, so that people in fact have a new normal. And some of these cases, but they're certainly aware of changing water. What this leads to is sort of the, what I'll be getting to is one of the challenges of the book. I like the idea of covering three cases. I like bridging the US and Peru and having Europe in there as well. I think that it's easy to read books as being about us or about them, and this is about us and them. But writing about three cases, quickly get into the, I can't even say on one hand than the other, because there's three of them, and then it's sort of tedious. So the challenge is to how to bring that forward. In any case, the Peru case has a lot more to do with social competition for water as well as changing supply. New groups trying to tap the same streams, I think, is what's more urgent. In Italy, they are more conscious of the flow, and that's the hydropower plant. And in Washington State, the and there's the questions in Washington State have in part to do with fisheries as well as because these are fisheries that are protected but also tied with tourism. There's also I did pick these cases because they're all near to glaciers, so I was the one who got to establish the criteria of near. It was up to me, and so I decided that there were long streams that come right off glaciers. So they also all flow into larger rivers and connect pretty quickly to larger rivers, none of which are international. So they at least you have that in common, that they're part of larger river basin management. But certainly, the water's important. The buildings, to me, seemed they're interesting. I think there'll be a way to hold the reader's attention in which a larger language of framing and projects would seem kind of elusive. And I think they're also important to the people, and I'm not sure how fully I'll explore all the ideas about landscape and tangibility, but the buildings really do also stand for something. Once they're built, they stay there and people see them, or they imagine that they will, and that's part of what they're doing in addition to managing resources. As I was preparing for this talk, it struck me that there's sort of, I could go sort of in a more resource direction or a more landscape direction, and those lead to different, so I did have the word manage in there, and that's a pretty resource word, but there are other words that are more on the landscape. Hopefully I'll discover the connections.
I'm curious, you were talking about the memory section and you were discussing how there are some similarities in these populations and the ways that they're referencing memories. And one of the things that stands out to me is that at least in the US case, you're talking about a colonial population. You know, you're talking about a population that probably displaced native populations in the area. So can you talk a little bit about what groups they're referencing? You know, are they referencing groups that they see as their own biological ancestors, or their cultural ancestors, or their spatial ancestors?
Sure. So I mean, there's it's the Incas also. I mean, absolutely, it's a case, and there's the question of Native Americans in the Pacific Northwest. It's a very vital and live issue, and it's one that people who are who don't have Native peoples right in these communities nonetheless know that there are casinos nearby and there are treaty rights on the fisheries, so that they've got some of that. But they understand themselves more as the real Americans who made this place, who, in terms of the changing historical eras, this one of the communities used to be a lumber town, and the other had a big cement plant that was built when hydropower is coming in. And so people in the lumber community are very irate about this category of humans who they call enviros. Probably some enviros in this room right here. And they say, you know, that they really understood the forest and improved it, and by clearing the forest, created a greater, they can actually, I don't know if they, I'd have to check to see whether they use the word diversity, but they talk about a forest that has some open patches as having places for different types of creatures, and the trees grow better. And what a shame that they can't do that anymore, and they help make this place, and they remember a simpler time, and they see this as connected to something that happens in different, happened across America, but that for them is very specifically connected to the mountains and the higher portions of the mountains where they hunted and fished and supported their families. So that's how they understand it. So this is stretching a little bit to line these three cases up, and there's a certain amount of that. But my alternative would be to say that the people in Peru are indigenous, and they speak Quechua, and no one would have any questions about that. But then there is certainly a strong sense of being mountain people and very local in Germany. And so the Germans, this word they have, Einheimisch, means kind of this word Heim is cognate with our home, and that there's Heimat is homeland, but these are small places, and they're deeply attached to them. And they see themselves not just as being in their local community, but they understand there are other communities like that, so that they're part of what's kept this German thing going in the Alps. And, since Italy was on the losing side of World War I, so that's how the South Tyrol was removed. Although the elections, the issue remains alive in a little bit. I actually have to check to see of the parties that did well in the elections in Austria yesterday is one that wants it back, so remarkably. So these are different, and it's going to be a question. I don't mean to say that this lines up neatly, but This preparing for this talk and particularly reading Akhil's work, I was thinking of, or at least the titles of his papers, and I was sure I said something really difficult. Oh, citizenship. Oh my God, how could I not talk about citizenship? And I realized, in a way, this is one of the reasons. It's one of the reasons that I hadn't been thinking so much about citizenship is this very strong local identity, which I think ties in with the time scale, which comes with the slowness of glacier retreat. And that also, so we'll see how that unfolds. I know.
So, you know, I think the ethnography is really great. I'm really interested in it. I was curious if you've given more thought or any thought, I wouldn't necessarily myself, but maybe you have, to your intended audience, number one, and the pragmatic effect that you imagine. Obviously, there's so many debates surrounding these issues currently.
Yes.
That I'd be kind of curious to hear you flesh out, you know, how this this work fits into that.
If you think you're curious, I do have some thoughts on that, and I'll actually that does in a way lead into the sort of reflections of the book, which will be me talking rather than reading, for better or for worse. So maybe I could move into that. And I'll start by saying, the first point I have is that there are four sorts of things that I write about glaciers, and this will be the first book, and I've written some some articles as well, and co-authored, in fact, with Carrie Milch, who's here, my colleague, who's a colleague right here. But I also do have the website, as Lisa was mentioning. So so I write some posts, posts for that, and those just go out to a wider world, and those are typically 1,000 to 1,500 words, and have some pictures, and sometimes draw on conferences that I attend or just events that I see. And then the fourth point that I write about, that I actually am working on, reports. There's, and I'll talk a little more about that, but there's an organization that's producing a climate report. So I feel like I address different audiences. And the words that you asked about were audience and effect. And I hope there's an audience. I mean, there'll be some audience. I don't know how big. Effect is, you've sort of got a lot of people trying to roll this very heavy rock, and they're all sort of leaning on it and pushing it, and maybe they experience it as moving forward, so they think it's moving in the direction they're pushing. And if it's moving at all, it's because there are a lot of people who are pushing. And I think it would be very hard to disentangle effects of my particular piece from other related pieces. The chance is just how do I have this piece? I hope it would break down, it would help contribute to breaking down the us and them distinction. And I hope it would make, even as I think it's important to see climate change in a long time frame and to understand people's actions in terms of their senses, not just of what they need to do today or this year, or maybe even for their kids, but as part of something larger, I want to promote people seeing that. I also want people to see that it's immediate. So much of climate change is in the future. Its graphs start in the past and go to 2050 or 2100. So I think that these are places where climate change has been going on for a generation and a half. So I'm hoping to build awareness. I think it's likely that the I wrote a book about previous field work in Peru on the fisheries in Lake Titicaca that I had hopes for reaching out broadly to a wider audience. And I read it, had readings at natural history museums, and I confess, travel bookstores. People read books about other places there, perhaps for base motives, though we all have travel books ourselves. But it did end up finding its readers were largely through course adoptions at various levels, and I was pleased that it was offering graduate seminars in departments like this, and was in community colleges, and everyone seemed to feel it was written for them. So I would hope to be able to reach that. There's a question of how American a book is going to be if I'm trying to make it. Thank you. But I was, that's a question of audience that in a way connects with my second point, which is the title. And titles often come late in the process, and there's no need to pick them early. But the title that I've been thinking of is called The End in Sight. And I liked it because what I think it can accomplish, and I welcome feedback on that, what I think it can accomplish is that it takes an ordinary phrase and reuses it, so that perhaps captures people's attention for some seconds, which I think is what you hope for with the title. I also like that it has short words. I like that it brings the question of temporality. I like that it has the notion of vision, because it's really one of the simple things about glaciers is that you can see them, and people can see that the snow is, that the ice, that there's less ice than there used to be. But it also raises the question of if it's in sight, do people really see it? And there's also the question of where, how far in the future it is, something that I'll be exploring. So I think the title, I think it's kind of a nice title, though. The title of my book about Lake Titicaca was Lines in the Water, which I thought conveyed very neatly the two systems of assigning aquatic space, one by the government, one by the villages. They didn't line up, and so you bet, how could you draw a line in the water? And here are these two systems of lines in the water. And everyone just thought they're fishing. But it was, at least they got this about fish. So maybe not so bad. But anyway, so I'm thinking of the End in Sight. Does have that that expert in everyday knowledge, and has the idea of a broader narrative that is a context in which people talk and think. It really is good to have linguistic anthropologists around. I think conversation is tremendously important. I mean, I'm not, and I do work a lot with transcriptions and attentive to the use of language. And so, in some loose sense, so this narrative framing is important because it would be easy for me to say, these people all know that glaciers are retreating, what do they make of it? But it's not always in their minds, and there are many other things that are going on. You can have slowly changing things, aging relatives, your car is not in good shape, your whatever, those only register occasionally. My point being that when do those processes, they pretty much have to lead to speech for them to lead to action. And they can only lead to speech in speech contexts. If thought is also shaped by context, speech all the more. So in a way, thinking about the different contexts in which people can speak brings in the narrative element, I think it's there. And there certainly are these other, I don't mean just to sort of badmouth all the groups that are working on climate change, they're important to have them, but some of the efforts really do believe in this thing called a certain form of participation that involves a certain kind of meeting and a workshop that's really very heavily orchestrated. And so that's it. An NGO can call some people from a village together and make a presentation, and the people will do something, and that'll count. That's, I want to think of those as certain types of conversational contexts. I'm an anthropologist. Okay, so there are three structural issues to the book I see, at least. One is this local global gap. I think, you know, where anthropologists, ethnographers have to report what we see. Happens that people just are not using the people in these places do not use the words like adaptation and adaptation or vulnerability or greenhouse gas. They may know them. And so what do I do with that? That's verges on the question of denial. The many Americans who are just understandably very worked up about the climate change deniers in our own country and increasingly in positions of power. But I haven't quite figured out what I'll do with that. I don't want to be the anthropologist coming in and discovering that these representatives of larger agencies don't really understand what's happening on the ground. I would think that there'd be an opportunity for mountain people to engage in, there'd be opportunities for people like that person who's herding those yaks to engage in conversation, global conversations, the way that people from small island states and the Arctic do. But I sort of want to think that through. So that's trying to figure out how I position myself talking about that is one of the questions. That ties in with the second structural issue, which is writing about three cases. And sort of comparative studies just have I'll just say it, have really vanished from social science in the last three or four decades, period. I'm old enough, I'm not going to ask for a show of hands because I'd be appalled, but I grew up with books like Peasant Wars of the 20th Century and Social Origins of Dictatorship and Democracy, where you'd pick cases and you'd line them up, small number of cases, and you'd extract lessons. And I think that's gone, on the one hand, into either just more detailed case studies, historical, ethnographic, or some types of comparative sociologists and political scientists who have what they call big N studies, where they want just enough cases to run statistical analysis. If I had to trace the history of that, Jeffrey Page's Agrarian Revolt is possibly a transition book. So the books seem too orderly, too hypothesis-driven, too much sort of sorting out variables, and how can you do that with three cases. just in terms of framework, I think a lot of people would expect an anthropologist to look at one. But I really like, I mean, I do like how, I think it's actually important. I think they're important. I think there are things that can be gained by seeing how these cases connect. And I think there are enough balances of interesting connections and differences. So I think the way out of that, I think this just sort of the structural question, this is the writing, is that I think at least some of these chapters that are I'll be returning to work on will open in deep, rather than having the three cases occupying relatively equal amounts of space in each chapter in the same order, I'll open exploring. I will occasionally, there'll be a couple of things I can do that the reader will come to know. They'll get used to having three paragraphs, one per case. I think that'll sustain the reader's attention. And then I think I may have some longer scenes from particular cases that I'll explore in detail, and then find analogous efforts elsewhere. So the museum in the Italian Alps, where people, villagers, actually a single cohort of young men, are collecting objects that are emerging. World War I material that's emerging as the glaciers are retreating is just fabulous. And so that'll be something on preserving. And then there might be something smaller on like frontier days in Washington. So I think longer and shorter will allow the reader to engage and will allow them to have the places come forward without just being very tedious. So local, global, three cases. And then the other opportunity that I have, but it's going to be a challenge to bridge with the ethnography, is that there are two other things that are going on while I'm writing the book. One is connected with a museum. I, remaining in New York on sabbatical, I wanted to find a writing space that wasn't my office on my campus, because the problem I discovered isn't running into the people who I don't want to see, it's running into the people who I do want to see, and then I'm there all afternoon, and then I just have to live with that. Don't want to be on campus, and I'll go crazy if I'm in my second bedroom. It's Manhattan apartments are small. And so I lucked out and got a desk at the American Museum of Natural History. And so being able to write about the museum's a great entry into some issues. So there's the museum on the one hand, and then one of the international climate organizations is called the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, IPCC. This is a group that produces assessment reports that possibly some of you have heard of that are statements on what we know about what has happened with climate change and what we anticipate is happening. And that's the main group that the other group turns to, the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change that had the Kyoto Protocol and the Paris Agreement. So there's the science and policy organization that writes reports, and then there's the group that the government that takes action. So I'm part of a group that's writing a report called on oceans in the cryosphere, which is basically how the melting in Antarctica and Greenland is causing sea level rise. But there's lots else going on. Mountain glaciers are melting, many other changes in the seas, impacts on fisheries. So I'm part of the mountain chapter there. So I go to these meetings. I've been to went to the scoping meeting was held in Monaco, which turns out Monaco has a wonderful aquarium. If you're ever in the south of France, go see this. One of the princes had a yacht and got into diving, and so they feature oceans. And then there was one in Fiji just earlier this month. So I can write from being in the museum that has a large anthropology division in which the cultures of the world are all classified and exhibited in cases. And in some ways, the history of anthropology can be written through the history of the museum in a way, and the whole confidence of the museum that there is just a diverse world out there to collect, a world of a slowly changing world of there's the fossils, and then there's the division of paleontology. There's a division of there's a geology division. I forget his name, but it's got the rocks and minerals and the meteorites, and then fossils, vertebrates, and vertebrates in anthropology. Only five divisions. Anthropology is one of them. Used to collect the cultures, and it's now facing how things change. But it just even being able to write about going into when I go to the museum, I park my bike, I go past the canoe, turn left at the canoe, go through the human fossils, and then turn right at the meteorite, all of which are connected to ice, actually, because the canoe, the Northwest Coast canoe, comes from a community, a community that has a river that comes from glaciers. Human origins on a longer scale has to do with the ice ages and that led to climate changes in the African savanna. And the meteorite, this huge meteorite, this 4 billion year old rock, fell on the ice in Greenland. That's why it was preserved. So I can write about all of that. I can write about, it'll be, that'll be an opportunity to write about temporality, because these are objects of different ages and objects that were collected without an anticipation of changes. I think all of that's going to be, will be good. And so I have to figure out how to balance writing about that and the IPCC, thinking about the museum's tendency in a way to cover the past, and the IPCC covers the future. The museum classifies and distinguishes, the IPCC compares and homogenizes. It's potentially, it's a nice pairing that I don't mean to oversimplify, but it's yet another element that I don't want to have too distracting. But I think writing about the museum and writing about the IPCC is a way to write about expert knowledge and public knowledge, and to write about science in a concrete way, and in a way that, and so in a sense that ties in with Greg's question about audience. So, but it's going to be, so it's a challenge, but it's, I think the three sections of place, memory, and future will work, and I think some of the chapters I've sketched will remain, and some may divide or grow, but that's kind of where it's headed now. So maybe I don't know if there's a second, any additional questions, or?
That sounds great. I was thinking, I had two questions, actually. The first is just building off what you were just saying, then returning to one of your earlier points about how people take up the languages of the IPCC report or not, in different locations. Might it be possible to think about an IPCC as a place across space? That's just a question that I've not really thought through in any detail. The second is thinking about these three different places that we're doing work in. And I think, again, thinking about like climate language is one, like the sense of the glaciers that they have, of the mountains that they have, and describe so well, is the other. But I was wondering if there's another sense of practice, which is, you know, thinking about like social or economic aspirations, right? How do people join their social aspirations for a better life in any of these three sites, together with the fact that their lives are being undermined by practices, global and local, in the melting of the ocean? That's just an ethnographic question.
Sure. So, in terms of the IPC as a place across space, it is, it's a very, it's the intergovernmental panel rather than the international panel, and it was created by, it was jointly founded by a UN organization, UN Environmental Program, this thing called the World Meteorological Organization, which there are all these things that countries have. You know, they've got anthems, and they've got flags, and they've got soccer teams, and they also have weather bureaus. I mean, it's like, if you were to decide weather bureaus from scratch, there's either very small or very peculiarly shaped countries that don't really need them, but they have them, and they're under the World Meteorological Organization, forever they will be. But it's intergovernmental means that governments get to read over the reports and comment on them. And that's this 30-page chapter that I and 11 other people are going to take 2 years to write. One person could carve 30 pages of word in stone, I think, in that amount of time, but it's just, we go through a lot of reviews. But so the intergovernmental is a very specific kind of covering of space, but it also represents science, and so there's a long list of sciences, and those are also understood to be universal, or at least to be universal. So it does kind of conjoin those, so that is a broad thing. And that was another museum. That was another museum. IPCC contrast that the museum, in some sense. Imperial was the word that came to mind. I mean, it's a different. So the major 19th century. I'll have to read more on the history of 19th century natural history museums, and they have their origins and so forth. But they do, you know, this was founded as this was a post Civil War museum that kind of morphed. You know, one of its iconic character, Teddy Roosevelt, was involved in the West and in the Spanish American War. So there's kind of a sweep there. So they had imperial origins, and the IPCC is I want to think what word to use, but it's certainly different. In terms of people's aspirations, the word that I just wrote down that is very helpful for me is property, because in Peru and in Italy, the fact that the villagers own land, and it remains an important resource for their households, there is income that can be made. There's in Peru, there's some changes in the agriculture connected in some ways. As Conrad, they're getting involved in the international rose flower trade, so this they can grow roses and have them. Some of them go to the national market, while better roses go internationally. Some of them are shipped overseas. But and then there's a lot of they're still growing local crops that will always be there and are important to them and are source of security in a time when jobs in the coastal cities might not be so secure. And in the Italian case, this is family-based tourism, so that they're running small guest houses or doing work that's connected to them, so that there's some people have guest houses and some people have guest houses. There's some workers in the larger hotels that come from other parts of the European Union, but local, the people who don't have the guest houses can still be guides on the paths in the national parks. They can. There's some skilled work that roofers. Several of them are roofers. So that kind of ties them to the community and to the future of the community. And so the property would certainly be a link in two of those cases. And there's more mobility in the U.S. and always has been in this particular case. Trying to think. Property values drop sharply as you go from right along Puget Sound and the series of towns north of Seattle inland. So people can live there quite inexpensively, and actually commute to jobs. And so that's one thing keeping them there. But it is true that aspirations might, in some cases, would lead people to leave as well as to stay. And I don't. That's going to be another question of. That I think it does matter to people that the community, they individually, individuals and families, many of them have ties to these communities. And in addition, I think it matters to them that the communities continue. So when people discuss the low-lying islands that are being, will eventually be obliterated by sea level rise, there's the discussion of why won't it be satisfactory just to move them all to New Zealand or to the higher islands. It'll certainly continue to last. And there's some of that here as well. But I'd wanna could reflect on that some more.
Thank you. to return to the issue of sustainability, some of the issues that Greg Urban had raised. So you, this cross-cultural comparative perspective, it goes far back in time with geographers and some anthropologists as being a special kind of environment that people have some similarities in, and it's valuable to do these cross-cultural. So, and the whole thing of the specialness of mountains, I remember when the Journal of Mountain Research and Development came out, and for a lot of Andeans, that was kind of strange. It's like, you know, segregate your stuff, because the Andean means coast, islands, tropical forests, a huge area. And this journal was essentially siphoning off a lot of the articles and things into, and you published there,
yes.
And many people did. And the, you know, and I think it's Wilkin and Robert Nettie's work,
sure.
Of mountain peoples. And so, remember, you also were one of the first to do a glacier symposium for AAA, bringing in, it's a two-session day, bringing in people from all over the world dealing with these kinds of issues. And so that you sort of still see it as a sort of special kind of environment that stands out.
So, I mean, there are multiple terms here, and just in terms of writing the book, I think mountains, glaciers, it's got to focus. I think that's for the reader who I'm trying to tell something about the contemporary world and climate change, they'll get that this is a place where it's happening. And so that you can then like slice and dice these concepts in different ways, and walking the halls of the Museum of Natural History leads me to recall my distant graduate school days in a kind of way. So when you said cross-cultural versus and comparative, the comparative is often of societies, of kind of societies on a certain pathway, and cross-cultural does such a, it goes in a way, had its expression with the human relations area files, which is some of the thought that there are these cultures and they just have these elements and they can be compared, and so people thought that they could just extract cases, kind of test hypotheses with that. The museum, in a sense, grew up with an era of just collecting cultures and collecting them spatially and understanding their connections in terms of movement of culture traits. They were either diffused or invented, and so some of those environmental foci, in a way, were one of the ways cutting. I mean, this kind of you had a way for explaining things other than just the pattern of spatial movement of these cultural elements, and so there certainly are connections and things. So and the way to link this, let me to sort of come in. The incoming idea is that. Would be the two very different uses of the word adaptation. The earlier use would say that you find similarities in cultures where people have adapted. That's important in the origins of agriculture. That could be important to pastoral nomadism in certain grasslands. There are a series of cases, certain types of tropical forest horticulture, just these kind of convergences, this sort of adaptation. In mountains, you could look, if you look for those in mountains, kind of put the cultures and array them on a table and show them the right kind of light on them and photograph them from the right angle, they look like they lined up too. I mean, they have differences because of their engagement with different wider systems that aren't just these local mountain environments, but there's some patterns of that too, valley centers of power and mountain peripheries. But that's the earlier meaning of the word adaptation from kind of cross-cultural study, and then there's the new meaning of the word adaptation in climate change. And so there is that's certainly another strand running through through all of this. Mountain research and development, in a way, grew out of some of its roots were this long-standing kind of German love of forests and mountains, and German geographers who could never get enough of the Alps, but who also involved in some international and some bilateral post World War II aid programs in the context of emerging environmentalism, some of which were national but had international, the Stockholm Summit and so forth, led to the emergence of fragile mountain environments. And there is deep concern about erosion. One of the lines that I'd like to trace through is the expansion of, this is the sort of, with three cases, and with someone with a, someone as distractible as myself, lots of lines to follow up. One of them has to do with the history of eucalyptus in the Andes. Eucalyptus has been there for, since certainly the late 19th century, but there was some expansion post-World War II, and I think there's some connections to the efforts to stabilize slopes, and people really saw erosion as the great threat to mountain environments. Overpopulation, deforestation, shortening of fallow cycles, cash economies just meant that people were overtaxing the environment. And if you look for erosion, you can see it. You can see eroded slopes. And so eucalyptus stabilizes slopes, and it turns out it's a very useful tree in many ways. Good for construction, good for a medicinal plant, but it's there's growing demand for wood in cities. As provincial cities are expanding, increasing demand for bricks and for wood to run brick kilns and bakeries. And at a time where there's increasing migration, eucalyptus groves are not only a way to get a source of income, but they're a way to handle both individual and communal land, because they fix tenure in a context, whereas if you're growing annual crops, it's harder to maintain your claim. So eucalyptus has spread, and it also uses a lot of water. So there's a whole question of the interaction of eucalyptus and water demands, and Peru story might lead a chapter, and might become somewhere. Anyway, that's sort of rambling quite a bit from your question. I don't know whether I answered it or just sort of battled, but it's.
I'm curious about you talked about sort of the remote past and the remote futures that you're discussing, and I'm wondering if you can tell us a little bit more about the time scale that these communities think on, because when we're clearly talking about landscapes that haven't been stable in any true sense, and, you know, ever, maybe.
Yes.
And so what do these communities actually think about how change is happening now versus the histories, these long remote histories of change that have taken place in the past?
So I think I've called the section memory, and memory it's a word I could use, it's a word that works well. It's how people, they understand their past in a certain kind of way. And I mean, Philadelphia is a good city to talk about that, and it's a city where people know that there is a past. And so, I'll get to your question in a moment, but this reminds me of one of the other things the IPCC produces no end of their reports, have lots and lots of figures, and the figures often have just many, many different variables on the x-axis, on the y-axis, but the x-axis stably is years. And so it's makes sense to them that you're trying to make projections into the future, and they often run them to 2030, 2050, and 2100. Even though there's lots of stuff that's going to happen after 2100 that's going to be massively serious, hard to get people to think about it. And in different ways, in these communities, people anchor some events with years. Some things are very anchored in years, and some things are not at all anchored in years. And so when I think of past and future time, people can array them I didn't like dive deep on this, but I think it's likely that they can array some things as more recent and more distant in the past and the future. And in terms of the changes, I can call a few examples that can come to mind. I think with more thought I might give a fuller and possibly quite different answer to what's an important question. But I think they can, they're certainly very aware of changes in the built environment, in the houses, in their diet, in their work patterns. They would be, they can recall, there are some major floods that they can recall some specific events. Have to say I'm pretty surprised that I didn't hear more in Peru about the huge the earthquake of 1970. Hear some about. I expected to hear more about it, considering how destructive it was. I think they've been through a lot since, in agrarian reform and the kind of Shining Path terrorist movement, and so in a way they're leaving that behind, even as they're aware of that. But so in terms of landscape change, of what just the different extent of forest cover, or in Washington State, they're aware of the changes in forests that come from the changes in forestry. But beyond that, I don't know. So a question that I'm of, I do have opportunities to answer specific questions, to ask specific questions. And one question that would be interesting to know is whether people in Peru think of the eucalyptus as an indigenous tree. They certainly think of some European crops as indigenous. They think that the Inca is a fava beans, for instance. But I don't know what they think about eucalyptus, but I'm not sure if they're incorrect, if they have a belief that we would not be incorrect, but still doesn't mean that they don't. They can still have a kind of memory. Yeah.
In terms of your three sections, it seems like, I'm curious about your conceptualizations of place. To me, it seems like place very much is kind of a laminations of meaning that are either imbued by memory or by aspirations, so kind of a future temporality, the orientation to a location. So how is it that you're hoping to get a place potentially separately from those two other sections?
So this is a question that's been asked me before, sometimes by geographers who use the word culture with an abandon and alacrity that appalls anthropologists. And my use of the word place is the same for geographers. It's like, how can you just, don't you know? And I try to conceal the fact that actually I don't. I'm just sort of using it in what I take to be a sense. I think when I'm talking about place, I would, some of the things I'll be writing about will be more connected to activity. The word experience, I understand, is a very problematic word. How would you ever really know what someone's experience is? But talking about people moving through space, the ways that they engage with places, and of course the permanence of the natural world, you could say is the permanence of places, and that does involve a temporal extension on either side of the past and future. But I think I'll start this section as I'm now thinking of it. There'll be chapters that are basically about exposed rock, and one about ice, and one about water, and so and those are all connected to the glacier, and they're all nearby. So. So I've thought of the word place as kind of a good short word. And I think a word, we have this word environment, and hearing environment, nature, place could possibly select among them. But place is a word that I've just thought cover them well. And nature would be a possibility, but I think it leads people in another direction of getting them particularly in the case of water, which is so influenced by canals that people have built and so forth. there, one of the things that comes up with comparative writing about three cases is just this, the vocabulary is difficult, not just in terms of there being theories or disciplines or bodies of literature, but just even trying to line these cases up. Like, what's currently troubling me is where these people live. I don't like the word community. It's kind of long, and the community seems a little long, and it works best for Peru, and it has all the associations of harmony and egalitarianism, but it's also just long, and I thought of NPR, and I don't mean to say NPR, but it seems like it's a certain kind of way of speaking that's, the word town works fine in the US, could maybe use it in Italy. Town really would not work in Peru, the towns where the Spanish-speaking people live down along the river, the main river in the valley, and these are indigenous people up in the mountains. Village is a little cute in a way, or will strike some readers as cute, and would work fine in Peru, in the Alps, but would not really work to describe these small towns in Washington State. Because if you say village in the U.S., you're thinking like New Hampshire. And I don't want to say settlement. So I don't know what I'm going to do. I really don't. That won't be the worst thing. But there are things like that occur again and again. There's also this word for festival and ceremony and ritual that I don't know what I'm going to do with. And so.
Thank you very much. That was interesting. Thank you.